What's up, interview hackers? Sam here from bytebybyte.com, and in this video, I want to address a question that was asked to me by one of my students the other day. And the question was, given everything that's going on and given the fact that all of our interviews are shifting online, should I be changing the way that I'm preparing for my interviews? Since he was asking, like, you're not obviously going to have to do whiteboard interviews in the near future, so does that actually change the approach when we're going into our interviews? And I thought this was a great question, so I wanted to answer it here. Because there are three things that I want you to think about when you are preparing for your interviews now, in the sense of how have things changed and how should I be thinking about approaching these interviews differently versus how should I be thinking about approaching them in the same way. And so the first thing that I think is really important that I tend to see a lot is that when we practice interviewing in a particular way, then when we shift the environment, a lot of times all that kind of goes out the window. And this is true for lots of things where if we practice a certain way in a certain environment, when we transfer to a different environment, we don't necessarily do the same things. And so what do I mean by this? It's like when you're in your interview, a lot of times if we practice on a whiteboard and we practice going through that process, there are certain things that we do, right? We talk out loud as we go through the interview. We have maybe a framework that we're following, a systematic steps that we can actually apply to solve the problem. But then when we get when we transfer to a different environment, like doing a phone screen, like doing an interview online, we kind of throw all that out the window and we just start from scratch all over again. And so the first most important thing that you can do is keep following the same strategies, keep using the same techniques, and keep doing everything that you've been doing, but apply it in this other situation. So yes, obviously you're not literally going to be drawing stuff out on a whiteboard, but all the actual problem solving approach and everything else should be the same. So practice, shift your, you can shift your practice so that rather than practicing on a whiteboard, you're practicing with like an IDE or practicing with a, you know, online code editor or something like that. But the fundamentals should not change. And so that's really important. That's thing number one. When you are doing these remote interviews, make sure that you are remembering to apply those strategies. Make sure that you're remembering to be systematic in your approach and you're not letting yourself get completely thrown off by being in a different situation. The second thing that's super important is always have a pen and paper with you. Yes, you're not going to be able to show what you're drawing out to your interviewer, but this is so, so important because there are certain types of problems where it just is totally different when you can sketch it out. Like think about, for a simple example, think about trying to reverse a linked list. If you go and try and reverse a linked list, yes, you can do it without sketching anything out, but if you can draw the like nodes and then draw the arrows going between them, it makes it so much easier that if you don't have that, it's really going to make it a lot harder for you to solve the interview question. And so yes, your interviewer is not going to be able to see it, but if you were drawing on a piece of paper, you can explain to your interviewer what you're doing. You need to make sure that you're communicating clearly because they're not going to be able to see it. But remember that your interviewer is familiar with the problem already. So chances are you could basically say, okay, well, I'm drawing the nodes and now I'm trying to figure out what the order of rearranging the pointers is going to be. They'll have a pretty good picture in their head of what you're doing as long as you explain clearly. So feel free to use that piece of paper. Feel free to have that by your side as you're going through these interviews, even though it's not on a whiteboard, because it's going to make a huge difference in terms of your ability to solve the problem. And now the final thing that I want you to keep in mind is that in a lot of these cases, so you're going to have, depending on the company, you're going to have different tools available to you. So like, for example, Google for their phone screens often uses Google Docs, and that, you know, obviously you're not going to be able to compile your code there. Some companies use Collab Edit where you also can't compile your code. But if you have a tool that allows you to compile and run your code, you should be taking advantage of that. So what I would highly recommend that you do is reach out to your recruiter and see if you can figure out what specific platform you're going to be using, because that would allow you to practice with that specific platform and know what to expect. But if you are given a platform, if you are doing this on a platform that allows you to run your code, use that to your advantage. So normally when we're on a whiteboard, it's really important that we test our code by hand, right? It's important that we go through everything line by line and make sure that we understand, okay, well, this is what this line is going to do and this is how it's going to affect the input. And we go through that process because there is no way for us to run the code. And so we need to know that our code is going to be correct and that it's going to operate the way that we expect it to without being able to actually run it. But if you can run it, if you do have that tool available to you, you want to take advantage of it as much as you possibly can, because it's really going to make it, it's going to give you an opportunity to actually demonstrate, like, hey, I kind of know what I'm doing. I know, like, how to debug my code. I know how to fix it when things go wrong. And so you're actually demonstrating those skills that people are going, that your interviewer is going to want to see. So when you have that opportunity, don't spend lots of time testing the code by hand, because it's also going to take a lot of time. Just go, you can go immediately to, like, let's run the code, see what errors we get, then fix it, see what errors we get. Just make sure that you're systematic about testing it. And so with that, you know, it's not rocket science, right? Things don't dramatically change when we move our interviews online, but knowing a few things that you can focus on and a few specific things to think about can make a really big difference. So I'd encourage you to try those three things when you are actually going in and doing a remote interview. And with that, that's all I got for you. Again, if you enjoyed this video, make sure you go to bytebybyte.com/50questions and check out our free 50 coding interview questions guide. I think you guys are really going to enjoy it. And I look forward to seeing you in the next video.